day I see what Christ He did for me. And every day receive His love for me. For upon the cross He gave all that I'll ever need. When He rose up from the
everlasting God. And I will rejoice in the
sing of the love of the Lord forever. Oh, you shall sing of the glory, sing of the mercy, sing of the love of the Lord forever. Forever and ever. Oh, now sing of your justice, sing of your judgment, sing of your everlasting covenant. Oh, you shall sing of your justice, sing of your judgment, sing of your everlasting covenant. Your covenant. Oh, and I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice. So I will rejoice in you, oh Lord. Oh, I will rejoice. Oh, I will rejoice. rejoice in you, O Lord. I rejoice in you, O Lord. I rejoice in you, O Lord. My God, now I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I rejoice in you, Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in you, Lord. Always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, I will rejoice in you, Lord. Oh. I will rejoice. Feel my strength, my refuge, my heart tower, my deliverer. Oh, we sing, sing, sing your praise, Lord Jesus. We sing, sing, sing your praise. Oh, we sing, sing, sing your praise. Oh, forever, oh Lord. We will sing, sing, sing your praise. Give you thanks. We sing, sing, sing your praise. Oh, we sing, sing, sing your praise. Most High. Oh, we sing, sing, sing your praise. Oh, we sing, sing, sing your praise. Sing your praise.
Your praise,
Lord, we sing, sing, sing your praise. 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 Lord, we sing, sing, sing your my life, Lord, be glorified. Oh, be glorified. Oh, in my life, Lord, be glorified. Oh. Come magnify thy name, Holy Spirit, magnify the name of Jesus. In my life, Lord, be glorified. Oh, be glorified. Oh, in my life, Lord, be glorified always. Oh, how oh, how marvelous is my Savior's love for me. Oh, how wonderful. Oh, how marvelous. And my song shall ever. Come let us adore. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come let us adore him.
Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him, Christ the Lord. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy. For you alone are worthy. Oh, Christ the Lord. We'll give you all the glory. Lord, we give you all the glory. Lord, we give you all the glory. Our Redeemer Christ the Lord. Come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Christ our Lord. Lord Jesus, we love you. Lord Jesus, we adore. Jesus, we're so thankful. Oh, Christ the Lord. Lord Jesus, oh, we love you. Lord Jesus, we adore you. Lord Jesus, we're so thankful. Oh, Christ, our Lord.
Just give him an applause, clapping his worship. God is so good. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And Holy Spirit, take my life. I put it on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life. I put it on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life and place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me.
Oh, Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall, let your fire burn in me. Husband me, Lord, I'm your husband. My husband, man, I belong to thee. Holy Spirit, take my life, place me on the altar of your praise, and let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Woo-hoo! Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for such a great salvation, such a wonderful love that you poured out upon us. Lord, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus that there would not be one person standing in this place today that is somehow refusing the life that you give, refusing the love that you provided for us to live. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would overwhelm every person where they stand. Father, we thank you that our praise is holy and it's acceptable to you because of the blood of Jesus, because of your mercy, because of your grace, because of your goodness. Oh, mighty God, we love you. Hallelujah. Thank you, living God. We pray in the name of Jesus that not one of you will continue to be sick if you're sick. No disease in your body. Hallelujah. No affliction or torment in your soul. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. It's not supposed to be there. You say, well, I prayed. Well, Jesus prayed. Whose prayer are you going to go with? He said, you prayed. But Jesus already prayed before you prayed. And he prayed that you wouldn't be sick. Amen. So why don't you just start deferring to his prayer? Why don't you just agree with his prayer and say, well, it's just got to be this way. You may be seated. You know, for me, you know, people, I watch people constantly being defeated by the circumstances of life. By the circumstances that they go through. Somebody says, what does it mean to be defeated by circumstances? It means that you change what you believe and what you're committed to regarding what God most absolutely said in his word. He's made things very, very clear to us. You know, if the Lord would have meant that we needed people who were full of great wisdom and insight and understanding, intellects superior to all the rest of mankind around them, in order to be able to understand his word and his message, then he would have told us so. But actually, he said, Father, I thank you that you've hidden these things from those who are of superior intellect. Those superior intellect in their own mind. The wise and the prudent. Wise and prudent with respect to, they got an A on all the tests. Everybody around them says, my, you know so much information. My, you know so many things. And you've revealed it to the babies. You've revealed it to those who don't know anything. Those who are willing just to simply believe, ask, and you shall receive. The intellect comes along. We must figure this out. Ask and you shall receive. And they break it down. And they go back to the etymology of words. They go through the historical, you know, etymology of linguistics back from the first word ever uttered. Up into the value and the meaning of what that word means. Is defined as today. It doesn't work that way. God the Father has asked us to simply believe his love that he has for us. You know, when the Lord Jesus came and addressed people, he did so in the context of mercy. It was only after their insistent refusal of God's love and grace that he began to reprove them and begin to rebuke them. And, you know, I believe today that we find ourselves in a church and in an environment that needs a whole lot of Jesus reproof and rebuke because we're not willing to believe. I mean, we believe as long as we agree with that is the way that we think it ought to be. We say, well, I must have life circumstance and experience help me to interpret what God's word has said. And I think that probably, well, I'm pretty certain that the most divisive and most demonic thing that Satan has ever done in the world of men is to bring out this report that the Bible is open for any interpretation. Many people interpret it differently, is true. But the fact of it is, well, better, higher than fact is truth. The truth of it is, the Bible doesn't have many interpretations. It simply has one interpretation. Jesus was born of a virgin. Interpret that.
interpret it, because many people want to interpret it. Say, see, you guys can agree, all of your different denominations interpret it differently. I don't care about all the different denominations. It just simply, Jesus was born of a virgin, and her name was Mary. And somebody wants to do some linguistic study on Mary and try to tell me her name's not Mary. I don't care. Her name in English today, right now, is Mary. And Jesus, it was the eternal God made flesh. Oh, eternal God made flesh, well, we got to interpret that. No, 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 you don't need to interpret it, because your interpretation is completely debunked. All it's going to do is create all kinds of confusion. And what you're going to do is you're going to subtract from God's word, and you're going to have your own religion. So why don't you just go on, get on with the program, write your own Bible? I know that no one will read it except for you. That's the sad thing about it. But if everybody would sit down and start writing out what they believe and then contrast and compare it to what God would say, you'd find out why you're not receiving what he's given. Because you got to believe what he said. You got to agree with him. Amen. Father, he petitions us continually, pleads with us continually. He begs us to come out of death and destruction. I want you to consider this for just a moment with me, please. Okay? And that is that the Lord's standing pleading with you to quit hating. He's pleading with you to quit lying. He's pleading with you to quit being sad. He's pleading with you to stop with all the fussing and yelling and broken relationship. He's pleading and saying, enough with the fight, enough with the anger, enough with all this stuff that belongs to the destruction of yourself and everybody around you. And this is what the Holy Spirit has come to do. He's come to teach us how to live the life of God, how to live in love, how to live in his joy, how to live in his peace, how to walk in everything that belongs to God's life and his goodness and his kindness and his mercy. And people are standing at the outside of the door looking at Jesus, and they're deciding whether or not they want to come in and live this life because they have a different opinion. What will you do with Christ Jesus today? You know, he comes to, I love the story of Jesus with the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well, Jacob's well in Samaria, because it just expresses so many things to us about God's love and about God's goodness. When he comes with the message of repent, when Jesus Christ comes with a message of repent, it's misunderstood. Jesus comes with a message of return to God. That's what repent means. It means to turn to God. And here he is with this message as he addresses the woman at the well. And it doesn't matter that she's been married 5 times. And that's, what is the worst thing you can think of right now in terms of sexual immorality? Because that would be the equivalence of a woman being married 5 times in that day and being living with a man who was not her husband. That would be the worst possible thing imaginable within the framework of that society. That would be the worst kind of person. So you think about what's the worst kind of person you can think of right now? That Jesus comes up to them and says, if you know who I am, if you would recognize who I am and the gift that I have, you would ask me and I would give you to drink. And he's really saying your entire life would be changed, your entire emotions, your appetites, your attitudes, the thing that you desire. I put inside of you a wellspring that will satisfy everything about your life. It is the very life of God. It is satisfying everything about your soul, everything about your need and your desire, and you won't be marrying anymore, and you won't be looking for all these, you know, solutions to your crisis, to your hurt, your emptiness, by doing all the things that you've been doing that is always self-destructive. Every decision that you make counts. And so many times what God's people don't seem to get is that God, the Holy Spirit, is standing there working with us. He's also on the inside of us, doing everything you possibly can do to lead us and guide us to make a decision that will result in your blessing and will result in you living out a life that God has ordained, the kind of life that he lives. He looks at a woman so thrashed, and he offers her everything that heaven can afford. Offers her everything that heaven has. And it's just, this is the message. It is a message of return to God. People want to call repentance all these various different things. But reality of it is will you just decide that the way that you've been living and the way that you've been functioning and the way that you've been thinking is getting you nowhere? God wants you to come over into a place where everything about your life ultimately comes to a place where you choose what's right instead of choosing what's wrong. Amen. That you choose to love and bless instead of argue. Amen. You choose to be tender and affectionate instead of getting hard and callous towards the person who you're supposed to be expressing the greatest amount of love to in this life, and that's your husband or your wife. Satan is always attacking relationships because, you know, that's just the demonic world that men live in. Men chose to walk away from the wonderful place of relationship with God right off at the very beginning. Adam had an intimacy of a relationship with a father, and he chose to go his own way. And ever since then, it has been the legacy of man making his own choices outside of fellowship with God has been Cain kills Abel, and the list goes on. Men's iniquity becomes so terrible that God repents that he's made men because they look nothing like he intended for them to look. And here we are today in the 21st century, and people are still trying to decide whether or not they're going to agree with God's way. Well, if you don't agree with God's way, you're not agreeing with life. Jesus came and showed to us a love that is immeasurable. And there's no open doors for interpretation. He hung upon a cross. He was crucified there on a cross, looking at you and me, saying, I'm doing this for you so that you will no longer live in your sin. You'll no longer live in your iniquity. You'll no longer live in your sorrow. The prophet Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 53, he said in verse 4, he says, he was bruised for our transgressions. He was wounded for our iniquities. And the verse just before that says that he bore all of our sorrows. So I understand that what Christ Jesus was doing, all this love of God manifest, is breaking me out of prison. He's there on a cross. He's incarnated into flesh for the sole purpose of dying on a cross to take my transgressions, to be wounded for my transgressions, pierced for my transgressions, bruised for my iniquities, chastised for my peace. Can you listen to me? Yes. Well, if he's bruised, if he's wounded for my transgression, then that means I've escaped the transgression. I no longer have the transgression. The transgression has been paid in full, so that I don't have to continue on transgressing. Amen. So many people don't get it. They don't realize that the Redeemer made a way for us to quit transgressing and to start doing what's right. Hallelujah. What's so wrong with doing what's right? Look, the data is in. The information is in. It's obvious. Men are lost in darkness and hate and death and despair. Take a look and see. When's the last time you looked around you and saw what's going on in just from the perspective of the news? But you don't have to go that far. Just drive I-5 or 15. You're going to find out real quick how people feel. They won't even as much as just touch their brake and slow down 2 miles an hour just to let you in the lane. It's this hate and it's this evil and it's this iniquity that men are absolutely bound by, that God in his love died at Calvary's cross to redeem us. Now, there's not everybody. There's a lot of people just want to go on hating. They want to go on murdering. They want to go on destroying themselves and destroying everything around them. They're just in darkness, and they want it that way. But here's the light shining and saying, repent, return to God. There is a fellowship. There's a walk with God. There's a place where every day, every second of every day, you can be blessed because now you're empowered to make the right decisions that result in your blessing. Instead of constantly making wrong decisions that result in your cursing. The righteous flourish like the palm tree. The way of the transgressor is the way that is hard. People have gotten so mixed up with what it is that God has done for us. Instead of looking at the simplicity of a so great of salvation that came and redeemed us. You know, I'm going to go to, look with me here quickly. And I was going to start off with what Jesus said about this, but let me just start off with what he said to the Apostle Paul about this in Acts chapter 26. And this is really how he defines repentance in Acts chapter 26 in verse 17 and 18. This tells us of the message of repentance that we're supposed to minister to people, the kind of grace that God has given to us to talk to you about your soul and about your conduct. You know, people say, I'm not so bad, you ought to see my neighbor. I'm not so bad, you ought to spend some time with my brother. I'm not so bad, look at those people over there. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if you're comparing yourself to anyone but Jesus, you got a wrong model. If you're comparing yourself to anything but the love of God and the grace of God and the mercy of God and the forgiveness of God and its continual ongoing love and grace and mercy, you've got the wrong model, because God's not asking you to be like your neighbor, like your brother, and like the person over there. He simply said, no, I want you to come over here and learn how to forgive like I forgive. Look at how I forgive. I want you to come over and have mercy like I have mercy. Look how I have mercy. I want you to come over here and learn to love like I love. Look at how I love. I want you to come over here and learn how to live life right. Amen. Because it's obvious that men have learned to live life wrong. They live life wrong. The one thing that God is going to hold you responsible for on that day is how well you loved. People are constantly carrying offense and unforgiveness. They feel like they were mistreated. Somebody did them wrong. Nobody's done you wrong but you. Amen. You're the only person that done yourself wrong. Amen. Because you didn't forgive when somebody did something bad to you, because people are going to do wrong. It's how you respond to the wrong that's ultimately going to make, you know, give the results in your life at the end of the event or at the end of the day. Repentance is God just crying out to us and saying, guys, you are living one messed up, dysfunctional life. Wouldn't you like to get this right? Yeah. Guys, you are bent on just destroying yourself and everything around you, and I pity you. Can I please help? And now people are acting like, well, God's asking us to do things, you know, to just... He wants it his way or the highway. That's like you saying that I'm not going to have murderers in my house or it's the highway. I'm not going to have people around me that are going to kill and steal and destroy or it's the highway. What do you mean? God's saying, no, I'm not going to fellowship with death. I'm not going to give myself over to all the perversions and the iniquity of men. Every sin only leads to more sin. Can you hear me? The Bible shows it. All Adam did and all Eve did was transgress God and disobey him at one point. Just disobeyed him at one point. But it was the most essential point. And think about this. They could do anything. Everything before them was theirs. And God had blessed them with everything. And they become fixated on the one thing that God told them not to do. They could have been distracted with all the million and one things that they could have been doing with their life and with their time. How many trees were in the garden? Why are they fixated on messing with God's, you know, stuff that he says is mine? Don't touch it. Leave it alone. You can't have it. Man, one simple act of transgression, people try, oh boy, do they ever go to interpreting that one. Look, it was a fruit on a tree. They ate it, period. Somebody says, your problem is that you're an ultra-literalist. Well, I don't know how to be anything else and get the message that somebody's trying to give me. You know, when you start telling somebody something, you want them to be an ultra-literalist with you. Amen. And I sit there and interpret it, this is a simile that we've got, this is a parable, we got to try to figure. You want to just listen to what I'm telling you. Amen. You tell that person, that your husband or your wife that you love dearly, you tell them what you need. And they come back and they don't totally disregard it from your perspective. They come back and they tell you, well, I thought you were speaking a parable to me. I thought that was an allegory. No, you want everybody to be very, very literal with you. Yes. Otherwise, there's no communication whatsoever. One simple act of disobedience. The people just have a hard time with, how can God be so intense and so radical when he's with just over one simple little thing? I mean, come on, give me a break. Let him eat the fruit. You're missing the whole point. God gave them everything that they needed for their life, and that was one thing that they couldn't have. And there was an absolute, you know, importance, demand that men God's creation, have a relationship around him, with him, that was based upon obedience, based upon trusting him, saying, listen, I know what's good here. I've been here forever. You just started today. Listen, I want to help. I want to train you to where you can walk in all my ways, and I can endow you and empower you with everything that I have. Now, let me train you. Now, everybody in the realms of humanity are happy with that as long as they're paying for it to have a teacher come and give them a skill set that's going to make them successful. But as soon as God wants to teach us something, we're saying foul. His way or the highway. No. No, we're twisted in our judgment. We're messed up in our thinking. We don't understand what God is saying. He came and delivered us from so great a death and so great a darkness, giving us an opportunity to return unto him. The law demanded perfect obedience. The Holy Ghost has come and supplied it. The law demanded men to be perfectly obedient based upon their own human effort and human ability, lost in the jungle of their own thoughts and thinking and opinions and perception. And God, the Holy Spirit, comes and brings to us the spirit of wisdom and revelation and insight so that we may know God and see how beautiful and wonderful he is. And they give us an opportunity and an empowerment and an ability to behave ourselves just like him. Yes. Hello. Yes. Wouldn't you like to learn how to love like God loves? Yes. What's so wrong with that? Wouldn't you, and here's something that people really have a horrible time. Wouldn't you love to learn to be meek like God is meek? Oh, doesn't that ruffle your feathers? Because if you're, especially if you're in the USA and, you know, you got to take up arms. I mean, everybody's got their little pea shooters, their little pistols. And God, a preacher was showing me the other day his gun, said he's licensed in 48 states. I said, my goodness, what are you doing with that, man? And what are you going to do with that? I said, the only person you even need that for is someone who's going to commit to shooting you in 2 seconds. Therefore, you must be committed to shooting them and killing them in the first second. Is that who you are? Is that what God has taught you to be? You know, it's the reality of it is that people live in their little, you know, bubbles and their little isolated worlds and their concepts. And you know, my goodness, We're going to be and live out a life that we've been conditioned to live. And within the framework of our perceptions, we make our judgment. Well, God has stepped in and not given us a global worldview. He's given us an eternal universal view of things. He's given us wisdom and insight. He says, don't do that. Rather do this. If you do that, you're going to die. It's a dead-end road. You can't see the end of that decision right now, but I can, and I'm promising you what it's going to result in. One little act of disobedience, give me a break, eating some fruit, will ultimately lead to men becoming so wicked that their imaginations of their heart are only evil continually. One act of sin will ultimately bring you to a place of such deception and darkness. There will be no likeness of God in you. There will be nothing of truth in you. It will all be false. It will all be fake. It will all be hypocrisy. It'll all be a show, a pretend at best. And then you won't even care about pretending anymore. God in his love and his mercy came and redeemed men. That means that he gave to us an opportunity to have every sin and every iniquity erased by the power of Emmanuel's blood, by the oath of God to remember our sin and iniquity no more. There are so many people who have broken relationships simply because the wife or the husband's remembering what their spouse did 5 years ago. Even worse than that, 15 years ago. Even worse than that, 50 years ago. Here's two old people, you know, they're walking down the road, you know, and she's still telling him about what he did to her 50 years ago. And there he is, you know, just all beaten down. You know, she's 86, he's 89. 50 years ago. And that's all he's heard for 50 years. He's lived in a prison of constantly being reminded of his one transgression. That's men. At their best. totally messed up and dysfunctional. They need psychologists, psychiatric help, medication. Are you listening to me? God has given us the cure. He's given us the cure. And we're sitting there looking at it going, well, I don't agree with it. I believe this or I believe that. Well, the Bible's open for anybody's interpretation. No, it's not. The wages of sin is death, period. It's literal. Amen. The gift of God is eternal life. Amen. Obedience in the scripture is simply defined as faith. Disobedience or unbelief are simply just is defined as disobedience is defined as unbelief. And obedience is defined as faith. To walk with God, to have a trust relationship, to say, somebody's got to be the leader here. What, we going to defer to you? I pray not. Would you like to live in a universe that I created and that I was making the decisions on? No, neither would I want to live in yours. I want God's. Yes. He knows it all from the beginning to the end. Hallelujah. He's not going to change his opinion. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's going to love you when he wakes up in the morning, so to speak. Really, when you wake up in the morning. Hello? Yeah. Everybody else is whatever their endocrine system is doing is what they're doing. Are you listening to me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
And then those of you maybe didn't get that, whatever your hormones are suggesting are imposing upon you. Hello? Why won't we? Let's let God be the leader. Yes. And he's condescended and better than that. He's loved us to such intensity that says, okay, I'm going to make a way so I can come and talk to you because you're so messed up. There's no way that you will in any way begin to relate to the first thing that I suggest. You can't relate to anything I say. The whole 1 Corinthians chapter 2 is devoted to that one message. You can't relate to anything that I say. So I'm going to give you a new heart and I'm going to give you a new spirit. I'm going to give you the cure. I'm going to work a miracle for you. I'm going to work a miracle of redemption. I'm going to buy you back. I'm going to bring you out of every day being taught to be a demon. Humanism doesn't like that one at all. You know, I was talking to an accountant the other day on the airplane and, you know, I was talking to him, you know, about his soul and about the love of God and telling him, you know, some different things. And I mentioned humanism, and he says, you know, he's going along, he's saying, well, what is humanism? He's saying, you know, I'm just as good as anybody else. He said, I really try to do everybody right. I don't cheat anybody. And goes through the list. And as he's going through the list of all the things that he does right, I looked at him, and I said, you're not good enough for God. And he got all kind of angry. I said, that's humanism. Because I didn't want to get to define it for him. I'm just going to set it up and let him feel it. You know what I'm saying? I do all these things right. You're still not good enough for God. You don't know how to love. Not really. You love those people that are good to you and that it's convenient for you to love. And as soon as they mess up, you're going to hate them. Because statistics say that you basically have friends for 5 years. You don't know how to do relationship. The divorce statistics show us just how bad people don't know how to do the most important kind of relationship. And Father's saying at the end, he's saying right there at judgment, he's going to say, I'm going to bring you to account on how well you loved each other. And all God's love, that's who he is. That's what he's doing. That's what he's brought us into. And it results in humility. And it results because as soon as you become aware of the reality of who God is and who you are and all the vastness of his goodness and all of his blessings, it humbles you. And you walk in humility, and it is easy to just be that same way with others and not the opposite of humility is being proud and boastful and demanding it be your way and oppressing people. What do you want, humility or oppression? Can you hear me?
Yes.
People, if there's ever a time, and I just stop and say this, if there's ever a time God's people in America need to pray earnestly, it's right now, because a house divided against itself cannot stand, and never has there been a greater chasm between the people of the United States of America. A categorical description of what's being now viewed as ultra-fundamentalism and Christianity, and categorically described as the same as fundamental Muslims, radical Islam, and radical Christianity. And the chasm's getting deeper and it's getting wider. And the results of it could be horrific. And people are saying peace and safety because they're putting their trust in a man, and they're putting their trust in legislative and judicial governance to make things, to set things right. Hello. I already know the end of the story. Fact of it is, I don't even have to go to the end of the story. I can go back in history and look it over and over again. If judicial and legislative proclamations, judicial and legislative administrations could make men right, could make societies right, then Israel under the leadership of Moses would have been heavenly. Because what better leader could you have judicially and legislatively than Moses, who is receiving direct judicial and legislative information and rules from God himself? It made men more violent and more worse, and it brought out even worse things in them because it was a testimony of how wrong they were. And here the Christian community is rising up. I mean, listen, I'm happy with politics that is going to go out against and shut down abortion clinics. But I'm going to tell you right now, people are going to get angry because they've already been given that. That's theirs. They want that. You got to change their heart. His heart's got to be changed. Hello. His heart's got to be changed. And I'm not going to get into all those political arguments. I'm not going to run them all down. I'm not going to chase them all down. I'm just going to tell you right now, the United States of America is not heaven. In case you didn't get the memo. The White House is not the throne room of God. In case you did not get the memo. And anybody can say Jesus, devils do. And anybody can come cloaked in majesty and righteousness and inwardly be raving wolves and destroyers. People, I'm not saying anything bad about anyone other than, listen, you're really messed up when you begin to put your trust in man, in governments, and especially if you put your trust in yourself. And I'm going to tell you right now, if I asked everybody in this place, how many of you trust yourself about 50%, everybody better raise their hand. Because that's the whole challenge. Because if you quit trusting yourself and trust only in God, we would have perfection. Hallelujah. We'd have love all the time. We'd have joy all the time. We'd have peace all the time. We'd have humility all the time. We'd have meekness all the time. People don't want to come to the school that Jesus is conducting because his schoolroom, his classroom is teaching you how to be meek and lowly. And where you learn that is when people are offending you and abusing you and saying all manner of evil against you and on and on and on. That's where you learn meekness and lowliness. You don't learn meekness and lowliness by everybody going, wow, you're amazing. God, I can't believe it. Hello. You don't want to come to his class. As soon as something offends them or even ruffles their feathers a little bit or somehow demotes them from the pedestal that each person has placed their own self on, suddenly they're done with you. They're done with this. I'm out of here. This is a life. This is not life. This is not life. That's what the Lord said. That's not life. You guys are living dead people. He that has and possesses this gift of God has life. That's why John said, he that has the Son, the only begotten one, the only begotten Son has life to possess Christ Jesus, where we become a new man, a new creation, who says within our heart and our being, oh God, I want to learn to do it like you do it. I want to learn to do it like you designed it. I want to learn to do life. So I'm talking about a life coach. Listen, the only life coach is the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I need a life coach. No, that's not going to mess you up worse. You know, I need to go to another motivational, thing so that I can, begin to feel better about myself because I don't have any confidence. It's just going to make you worse. Because self-confidence is just so destructive. It's so destructive. Huh? We call it... unconscious incompetence. It's true. It's true. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to today, I pray that I could move you into conscious incompetence. Oh, that isn't a motivational speech for me. That isn't going to get me up in the morning and cause me to believe that I can succeed. Good. Amen. Good. because if you'll just walk with God, success is already guaranteed. I'm telling you right now, everything that he has is yours. He becomes your God. You are his people. When God is your God and he's devotedly in love with you, affectionately in love with you, and on a scale that he's described at Calvary's cross, I mean, anything you ask is yours. You have need of nothing because you're led by your shepherd and you shall not lack. Hello. He'll bless everything that you put your hand to. He will promote you continually. People ask me over the years, says, why don't people stay in your church? Why does so few people come to your church? Because I demand them to get right. I'm not a facilitator. I'm a father. I'm a dad in the house. Are you listening to me? I demand you to act right. And saying, people want to be just left alone. Who are you? Who made you my boss? All these attitudes. It's not about that. It's not my opinion versus your opinion. If that's what it is, let's just all be quiet. And that we can live more peaceable lives. It's rather me simply being a representative of what God says and say, listen, this is the way, walk in it. This is my job description. My job description, what I do for a living is declare to you what God said in his word. He wants you to do what's right. He's not standing around judging you for all the wrong, because you're already judged if you're in the wrong. You were born way past your time. God judged it 6,000 years ago, approximately. It's already judged. It's already done. Wrong is judged. The gift of God has brought us life so that we can escape the judgment. He was wounded for my transgression. He was bruised for my iniquity. This is what God demands. He was chastised for my peace so that I can have peace. I'm going to walk in that which he's gifted me to have. I'm going to walk in a place of a relationship with him where there is no sin. Somebody said, no sin. Yeah, no sin. I said, well, I believe that's imputed. Fine. 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 But it's still no sin. He's given me his righteousness so I don't have to, feel like I'm alienated from him or separated from him or always trying to please him, because you could never live up to pleasing him. Hello. Amen. And you live under that intimidation which men put you through, which everyone knows very well about that kind of intimidation and fear, so we need no dissertation on that. God just gave to us his righteousness. He gave to us his holiness so that we can continue to be wrong. No, so we can learn to be right. So that all the time we're holy and acceptable. We're not trying to please him, and we're not trying to make him happy. We're not trying to earn something from him. He's gifted it to us so we can just be with him, so we can now be empowered, because that's what God does. He empowers us. He empowers us. Holy Ghost conviction says, don't do that. That's going to destroy you. And people say, oh, God's way or the highway. Oh, just a wrathful, vengeful, judgmental God. With wrathful, vengeful, judgmental people. Nonsense. Culture of condemnation. Nonsense. It's a culture of condemnation to you because you want to do wrong and not get right. It's no condemnation. There's therefore now no condemnation. I don't have any condemnation. I don't have any condemnation. I can sit and listen to somebody talk and just lay it out about the wages of sin is death, and those who do these things have no inheritance in the kingdom of God. They can spit and scream and holler, and I'm going to feel real good all the time. As long as they're preaching the word of God, I'm going to be happy with it. I have no condemnation. I'm in Christ Jesus. My heart doesn't condemn me. Therefore, whatever I ask the Father, he's going to do it. Praise God. And I want to stay there. I love the relationship. I love the love. So do you. So does every sane human being on the planet. Every sane human being on the planet loves the love and doesn't ever want it to go away, no matter how bad they act. Hello? God wants you to come into a joy that nothing that happens around you can make you any happier than you are. Whoa, what? What? God wants you to have a joy that nothing can make you any happier than you are. Because that's who he is. He's got so much joy, nothing can make him any happier than he is. Nothing. He's got fullness of joy. He's happy. Amen. He's got so much joy that any bad thing that people do can't make him any sadder or less happy, I should say. Because he doesn't have any sadness. There is no sorrow. And he wants you and I to step into his joy. Yeah. And yet all of his delights are with us. Amen. All of his delights are with us. Huh? He delights to be with us. All of his desires are with the sons of men. That's radical stuff. That's radical theological stuff. We say that all of his delights are with us. It doesn't need any interpretation. Delight. How do you delight with people? If you want to interpret, interpret it that way. Delight. Happy to be around you. Delighting in you. Oh, if we could just, if we can learn how to do it. I'm gonna follow him because I want Mr. Z here when I'm old and can hardly move around, 120, 130, whatever it is. I want him just walking in the power of the Holy Ghost, being blessed, having everything that pertains to life and godliness, and loving his really, really old grandpa. God made relationship to last forever. He didn't make a relationship that, and here we fall so in love with each other. We admire each other. I think, Lord, how could you have created such a perfect and wonderful human being when I look at my wife? I honor her. I love her. She's an amazing person. For that just to end in death and it's gone and it's over? God didn't intend that. He made love to last forever. It's men's concept that every good thing must come to an end. No, everything in good in God just keeps getting better. Yeah. It keeps getting better. He never meant for these relationships to come to an end. That's death and destruction. I look at people getting divorced and I think, my goodness, divorce, that's a relationship broken worse than death. Because it's a painful, constant reminder of rejected love. Who invented that? God came to deliver us from that mess. It personifies, it's a testimony to the mess that men are in. Is that what you want with your life? No, that's not what I want. I want all of my children around me. I want all my grandchildren around me. I want them all to be happy. Nobody likes to sit at the table, look at their children all happy and sad, go, good, this is just what I expected this morning. I feel good about this. I hope you're a little bit more miserable by the time we finish breakfast. That's warped, man. Nobody feels that way. But yet they have behavior that makes people feel that way. The result of their action results in them feeling worse after by the end of breakfast. They were bad. They felt bad when they got up. By the time breakfast is over with Dad, they are totally devastated. Huh? Because it's all about what men want in a wicked and evil world. And Father's come to deliver us from ourselves. Yes. Hallelujah. To teach us to walk, first of all, to deliver us from the power of sin and death. Yes. To deliver us from a demonic, tyrannical reign of the demonic realm. And to teach us how to deny ourselves so that we're delivered from ourselves. To now be trained. See, when we're born, the scripture says when we're born in sin and shaped in iniquity. In other words, we were born under the tyrannical reign of an evil ruler. And every day, we're taught and fashioned to be just like him. That's born in sin, shaped in iniquity. But when we're born again, we're born in righteousness to be shaped in holiness, to be taught by God, to be taught by God. What a privilege. The Lord Jesus comes with a message always, not in judgment, but in mercy. He says to the woman, he says, if you just recognize who I am and the gift that I have for you, you would ask me and I'd give you to drink. See, it's his gift being declared in mercy. It's only after the gift is rejected that judgment comes hard. Then he went, Matthew chapter 11, into all the cities where he did his mighty works and he began to upbraid them. Literally, it means to insult them. We don't want to do that because people don't understand God. Literally, upbraid them to rebuke and reproach them for their unwillingness to believe the love of God, for their unwillingness to change, for their desire to remain the evil and iniquitous people that they are. That's where judgment kicks in. You know, it's really kind of, you look at it even with the woman at the well. The Lord didn't really even start talking about her sin till she started saying, listen, how is it that you can give me this water? You don't have anything to draw with. So he said, okay, well, let me just dig in here a little bit deeper. How about your, go get your husband. Because now she's willing to come around. She's saying, well, give me this water to drink. He said, go get your husband. Well, I don't have a husband. Well, at least you're not telling a lie. That's what he says. Because you've had five. Huh? And now you're living with a man who's not your husband. You're a woman polygamist. basically. And look how simple he makes it. Look, he then said, listen, we got 5 soul ties to break. There's going to be a lot of inner healing. It's probably going to take us, I'm going to say, let's just give a year for each soul tie. He just makes it instantaneously in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. I'm not going to have all this other stuff that men are going to add on to this. I want what Jesus offered the woman at the well or nothing. I'm going to stay right there till I get Jesus, who is at the, like, just like the woman at the well, because that's the gospel. That's how Jesus presented the gospel. That's it. That's one of the great models of how Jesus presented the gospel. He presents the gospel by going and looking at people and seeing them afflicted and tormented in sickness and disease and curing them, making them whole, driving out the evil spirits that tormented them. That's the gospel. I'm bringing you the good news. I'm bringing you the deliverance. I'm giving you the privilege and the ability to no longer live under that stronghold of oppression, but now to be able and to, but to deliver you from it and now give you an opportunity to come and live in this relationship the way it's supposed to be, the way it's meant to be. In Acts chapter 26 and verse 17 and 18, Paul's describing the ministry of Jesus. Because the ministry of Jesus was given to Paul. The ministry of Jesus is given to me. The ministry of Jesus is given to everybody who's called upon the name of the Lord, who's been changed, who's been transformed, who's been filled with His Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. I've been given a Holy Spirit from the Holy Spirit. I've been given a Holy Spirit so the Holy Spirit can be with me and in me, and I can agree with everything that He says. But that comes at the cost and the expense of me going with what I believe because of what I learned. In the culturalization of the Western world, in a Greco-Roman culture, from the time that I was in preschool all the way through, Lord help us, because some of us have gone way beyond graduate school kind of thing. When you're repeating graduate school, you're just, what's wrong with you kind of thing, right? Now, we've been so, if we're not careful, we've been so lobotomized, we've been so culturalized, we can't think right, because God's going to talk to us, and we're going to always try to defer what His judgments are with the mixture of our judgments with His judgments, and worse than that, just to go with our judgment that's not a mixture at all. And that's what men do, and that's what you're hearing. That's what you're hearing from so many different places. And the pulpit and the church is absolutely, unfortunately, it's no exception. You're hearing all these lies. You're hearing all these things where it's blending the truth with the opinion of men. I say that's a lie. Right. It's a lie. You change the truth, it's a lie. Paul says, here's the testimony of what the Lord Jesus said to him. He says, delivering you from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom I now send you. Here's His commission. Okay. He says, here's what I'm going to send you to do. I'm going to send you to the Gentiles, verse 18, to open their eyes. How are we going to open their eyes? By declaring God's judgments. By declaring what God says. Declaring His decrees, His statutes. Because that's a different way to apply His judgment. Somebody says, you're judging. No, I'm declaring to you God's judgments. God has already judged. So I'm declaring to you His judgments. And if I don't declare His judgments, then I'm a deceiver. Huh? And what we do is when we come to open up people's eyes is we come to tell them there's a gift of God. God's come. The Redeemer's come. You don't have to live like you're living. You got to ask people, are you really happy with your life? And they go, yes, I am. Really, you are? If they're not between the ages of 14 and 17, they're lying. Between the ages of 14 and 17, you are mostly don't have a brain. Sorry, guys, from 14 to 17, you have no concept of reality. You make decisions without consequence. It's just crazy. But you're messed up. You got to protect 14 to 17-year-olds. You know, lock them in a room. Padded. No, not really. I'm just kidding. Oh, he said I was in the meeting. I've had people do this to me. I was in the meeting. You said. I heard it. I wrote it down in my notes. I'll get the tape. If they're between the ages of 14 and 17, lock them in a room. Child abuse. I'm reporting you. You need to protect your 14 to 17-year-olds. And the best way you protect them is you keep them in church all the time. Huh? You saturate them with prayer and intercession. You love on them. You care, you take pressure off of them, because we are a pressurized society of people gnashing and grinding their teeth. Ask the dentist. They're making more tooth guards over the past 10 years than they've ever made in modern times, because people are under such stress and such pressure. You're really happy with your life? No, the reality of it is in reality, men are not happy with their lives. In truth, they're not happy with their lives. They feel terrible about the way they've acted. And the Lord says, listen, are you done with acting the way you've been acting and living the way you've been living? I've come to give you life. I've come to teach. I've come to be your teacher. I've come to be your life coach. I've come to teach you. I've come to mentor you. I've come to help you. I've come to open up your eyes so that you can see that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. I've come to give you the ability to recognize that the choices that you make are the reason why you're having the problems and the issues that you're going through. So I'm here to teach you how to make the right choices. I'm here to teach you to turn off the television. I'm here to give you an appetite only for right, so that you're not watching lasciviousness that is planting seeds in your heart about perverted relationships, twisted relationships, perverted behavior and actions and attitudes. It's just seeds. It's seeds placed into your heart and your mind and the realms of your thinking that is ultimately going to grow into behavior and decisions in your life. I'm here to bring you to a place where you're not going to abuse human beings and look at them in a lustful way, because that's the same as murder, to destroy their soul. But rather, you're going to protect other people around you. And rather looking at something that you can use for your own self-gratification, you look deep within and you see a soul that is an eternal soul that's going to spend one place, going to spend eternity in one place or the other. And you want to do everything you possibly can to introduce them to a loving Savior, to a living God who loves them more than they could possibly ever understand. If God's people would start living the life that Jesus has given us, we would see a great change. We would see a great change. Because you and I are supposed to be a testimony and a light of how wonderful it is to live in joy and love and peace, how wonderful it is to be out of the prison of death and darkness, how wonderful it is to no longer be under the ruler of the tyranny, the rulership of the tyranny of the demonic, producing every evil behavior in men. Starting with bad attitudes towards one another. God's called you to lay down your life for one another. Wouldn't it be wonderful if the world could see God's people laying down their life for one another and quit instead of arguing? He said, I've come. Here's the gospel message. The gospel message, what you and I are commissioned to do is to open up people's eyes so they can clearly see what's going on. God will give us this ability by just declaring His word, because His word is powerful. He says to turn them from darkness to light. That's repentance. Repentance is to turn back to God, to turn to God, return to God. You're in darkness. Somebody said, oh, God needs a nemesis so He may be fully defined. That's like saying, come on. You know what I'm saying? Are you with me? It is so, the logic in it is just so bankrupt. It's like darkness somehow has to have a nemesis. You can only define darkness by the absence of light. Think about it. Huh? Can't define darkness by the absence of light. Because darkness doesn't even exist. It doesn't even exist. It's only defined by the measure of light. I don't want to get into physics here, because some of you are thinking too hard about it. God doesn't need a nemesis. He doesn't need evil to define as good. It's just so twisted. It runs bankrupt in any kind of real true logic. It's just wrong. God doesn't need your experiences of sin so that you can help other sinners. He needs you to experience righteousness so that you, hallelujah, so you can understand how good it is. Well, I've been divorced 5 times. I can help people that are divorced. I think not. Actually, that's a reverse logic, actually. If you messed up 5 times, you're the worst possible person to help somebody else with their marriage, because you think you got it right this time, and it's just as bad as the rest of the times. Give me a person who's never been divorced. That would be the one I would want to have as an instructor on how to do a marriage right. Hello. Well, it's got to be got a couple more conditions, huh? Because not only are they not divorced, but they love each other and they sleep in the same bed and they're best friends. Because there are people not divorced and they sleep in different rooms and they're just grumpy with each other all the time. Why? Because they're telling each other about what they did so many years ago. They constantly live in the offense. To turn us back to God, from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God. That's our message. That's what we're going to be doing. Here, see that? See, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God. So that they can receive the blessing, so that they can receive the promise of eternal life, so that they can receive forgiveness of sins, inheritance among them which are sanctified. Jesus said it, that's 26:18. Jesus said it in Luke chapter 4, verse 18. He says, the Holy Spirit is on me. You look in Luke chapter 4:18, in case you can't quote it. If you can't quote it, sometimes it's good to look at it anyways. He says, the Holy Spirit is upon me. It's what he's come to do. He's come to proclaim good news. Turn back to God. You can turn back to God. This is the day of the visitation of the Lord. You can turn back to God. You can come in and never go out anymore. You can now walk with him. You can come back into the paradise. You don't have an angel standing there with a fiery sword saying you cannot come into paradise. You cannot come back in a relationship with God. You've got an intercessor rather saying, everybody, come on in. Come on in. You can come on in. You can come on in. You can come in. Not to be continually living like you've been living, but to now be transformed and to be taught to live like God. Somebody said, I just believe in progressive sanctification. It's whittle by whittle. No, it's not whittle by whittle. As God whittles you down to nothing. No, it is not. It's an instantaneous relationship with God where he gives us his righteousness and he gives us his holiness. And then we every day learn and grow and mature in that because we love the relationship. We're not hanging out with God on Sundays and then going out into the world and hanging out with the world. That's why James says, you adulterers. What a Sunday morning sermon. You adulterers and adulteresses. Wow. Man, the church, if I preached like James, the church would be smaller. I know my wife would be here. My daughter's waving at me. She'd be here. My kids would be here. Because love would take you through a lot of rough places. Huh? Love would take you through a lot of rough places. Love will keep, if love is there and love is honored and love is valued and the laws of love are lived out, those are unbroken relationships. Hallelujah. God wants to teach you how to, parents, Father wants to teach you how to raise your children in such a way that they are so empowered by love. He's crying out for me. They are so empowered by love. They are so surrounded and immersed in love that nothing can break that. Nothing can violate that. Hallelujah. Praise God. Isn't the Lord amazing? Isn't it amazing? He brought through love his purpose, his intended purpose. He brought through the act of love, intimacy, souls that never existed before. Huh? And that go on existing forever. Because relationships never supposed to die. It's never supposed to be broken. Satan stepped in with his lies and his tyranny and has created death and destruction. The worst thing I can think about is souls being separated for eternity. But God blots out the name of the wicked so there is no more remembrance of them. Because there would be no way that I could ever think of spending eternity in God's glory and his presence while Z is burning in hell. And people get fixated on the judgment. Don't get fixated on the judgment. The judgment is the consequence of you rejecting God's love. To disobey God's remedy and cure for your life has got to be the highest, most flagrant act of disobedience. Can you hear me? Yeah. To reject his life and his love, it's the most flagrant act of disobedience. It's worse than anything. Jesus says, the Holy Spirit is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the good news. Return, you can return to God now. The angel with a flaming sword is not guarding your way back into the entrance. Come on in. Come in. Draw nigh. To bind up the broken in heart, everybody's hurt. That's what he did. That's his ministry. And he just walked up to people all broken in heart and say, listen, is this because of your sin, your iniquity, you rascal? I can't even believe that God would even be sending me to you right now, but here we are. And he delivers them from their hurt and their pain and their suffering. We're going to have to learn to preach the gospel and go heal the sick. People want to make it a power trip. It's not a power trip. It's the acts of God's love and mercy. It's the acts of God's goodness, meeting people right at the place of their need. And you want God to use you to meet people at the place of their need, and you're constantly creating hurts in other people's lives that are close to you? You need to stop. You need to be quit being so destructive so you can learn how to give life. Quit giving death. Quit giving sorrow. And God's people are peacemakers. They make peace. They don't involve themselves in strife. Isn't it good? Isn't God's mercy good? That even though we don't get it to start off with, he still works with us and says, you know, you're still a strife maker. You're still making an argument. Huh? You're still going around telling everybody what those things that you think you know that I know nothing about. Those things that you think you know about me that I don't know anything about, Father's saying. And are you with me? Huh? He just loves us, and if we're willing to get it right, hallelujah. But there has to be God has a strict rule of life. Because if we lower the bar, that's another gospel. You suddenly say, oh, it's okay, God understands. The people who are taught it's okay, God understands, never get it right. Because there's too much wiggle room for the devil, because that's nothing other than compromise. First and foremost, it's not the gospel. It's an interpretation of the gospel. It's a changing of the word of God. God's word is very clear. Amen. On these things. He brings an end to it, and into a former way of living. Crucified, buried with him by baptism into his death, raised up together with him, alive together with him, seated together with him in a heavenly realm. A whole new identity. You know, can you see how much I love him?
Yes.
Father loves you more. If you could just see it. I can help him. I can help my children from being messed up and dysfunctional, having a hard time relating to God. Because I can be an example of God's love by obeying him and doing it his way. I can love my children and my grandchildren so that they can have that much more appreciation and value for God's love. If I could just show you how much Father loves you, if you could just believe his love, you will be empowered to live a different life. And his love was supposed to be settled and proven at Calvary's cross. Hallelujah. It's just like holding Ruth Anna when she's a baby. It is. I look over there and I see Ruth Anna. I see her. Genetics is an amazing thing. You know, it's not only the phenotype. It's not only the phenotype, it's the behavior type. Okay, it's not only the phenotype or the genotype or the outward appearance or the inward, you know, genome or genetic information, it's the behavioral type. I was watching Miles, his little guy, the other day, and I just had a flashback because I remember Miles when he was just this little guy, this little type, and his son now has the exact same behavioral things that he and actions that he had. Tilts his little head and walks the same way. He didn't learn that because he never saw his dad do that. Fully on behavioral. And you and I got that. You and I have that for good or for bad. Huh? For good or for bad. And it's mostly bad. And the Lord steps in and gives us a new gene. Theology. Huh? Makes us a new generation. Hallelujah. He does. He does. By the washing of the water of regeneration. Hallelujah. I've been regened by the Spirit of the Lord for new behavioral types. Hallelujah. For, I mean, you know, it's in many respects a new phenotype because I'm smiling and not frowning. My demeanor has changed. I get to light up with it. I get to be changed to his image, to his likeness, to his looks. I get to look like him. That's good news. Unless you're still, you know, deceived and infatuated with yourself, your ugly self. And ugly isn't about phenotype, appearance, the way you look in the mirror. It's by the way you act. Amen. My wife and I, we had a meeting with some people. They never met her. She just had her ponytail on. She had no makeup on. And the woman comes to me and she says, "Your wife is so gorgeous. She's amazingly beautiful." And because her, and she's beautiful, don't get me wrong, but her, who she is, just her sweetness and her goodness and her happiness, and it's genuine. And she, you know, just, you know, it's like the guy that we were there with, he was a person we were renting some property from, and he's got a cold, so he doesn't want, you know, he doesn't shake hands or whatever, and just comes, grabs him and hugs him. He says, "You're not going to tell her to just stand back and shake hands or whatever." Because it's just this genuine goodness of God's love. That I personally would love it if everybody was like that. And so would you. As nobody wants to live in a world where everybody's ornery and cantankerous and upset. Hello. You would love for every, you walk in the store and everybody's going, "Hey, are you doing fine? Come on, give me a hug." You're like, "Whoa." Huh? Nobody's going to go, "Oh, please leave me alone. Don't touch me. I don't like to be touched." There are people that are that way because they've been hurt so bad. But Jesus gave you and I the ability to go deliver them. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to bind up the broken in heart, to fix them. So they want to be hugged now. Amen. If they're that warped and twisted. Listen to me. He's going to fix you. He's going to fix you. He wants to fix you. He's come to present a cure. Don't knock it out of his hand. Tell him you don't want any. To proclaim liberty to the captive, the open of the prison doors to those that are bound. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you're in a prison until you are willing to hear God's love extended towards you. And recognize that he is your redeemer. He's the one who holds the key to your prison and he wants you out. To proclaim liberty to captives. I'm here proclaiming liberty to you. I'm not here telling you to stay in the prison. Amen. I'm here proclaiming liberty. I'm here telling you, return to God. Return to God. That's all I'm telling you. And there's no way to return to God except for by the means by which God in his mercy made a way to destroy a tyrannical government that ruled over men and that rules over men. People say, "Oh, there's many ways to God." No, there's not. There's only one way. Right. Somebody, "Oh, that's narrow-minded." Well, it's narrow-minded then to believe that there's one sun shining on us. Sorry. It's narrow-minded to believe there's one moon. Sorry. Huh? It's narrow-minded to believe that there's a morning and that there's an evening. Sorry. There's only one morning and evening. There's just it. Of each day. You don't have two evenings. Now you're more open-minded because you got two evenings, three evenings. Huh? I'm sorry that we're not open-minded that you only have one name. What do you want us to call you today? We're not more open-minded that you're not more than one person. There's only one way. There's only one God. There's only one life. There's only one death. There's only one universe. Sorry we're not more open-minded about multiple universes. There's only one earth. There's only one Savior. Amen. There's only one person that came and said, "I am God, and I'm going to die for your sins so that you can go free from your sin. I'm going to break the power of darkness and the demonic stronghold off of you. And I'm going to forgive you of all of your iniquity. I'm going to remove it far from you." There's only one God. There's only one message of salvation. Nothing matches that. Buddhism is another expression of Hinduism. Hinduism is another expression of the Vedic. Vedic is Brahmanism. Brahmanism is another expression of ancient Zoroastrianism in the worship of Ahura Mazda. And you can go and you can trace all these religions, and they have basically one place from which they've expressed their ideas of who God is and who we are. And none of them has the remedy or the cure. Christ Jesus has the remedy or the cure. God wants you to have it. And if you say you have it, you need to start living it, because otherwise there's no testimony that what he's declared is true. You have a responsibility to live in joy as a proof that God is who he said he is, as you're going to say he's your redeemer and that this is what salvation looks like. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God wants it to be real and genuine in your life today. I pray in the name of Jesus that you'll be able to see so clearly like never before that he just called you to return to God. If you've not returned to God, if you continue to live out your own life the way you think it should be lived, today he's inviting you to come to him, to return to him. There's no way to live his life except to be with him, to have a relationship with him. There's no way to have a relationship with him but through the blood that Jesus poured out for us at Calvary's cross, through the power of the resurrection, through the miracle of the new birth. You've got to become different. You are not good enough for God, but he'll make you good enough for him by the miracle of salvation. He'll make you holy and acceptable by the miracle of salvation. This is the grace of God, this is the goodness of God. Everybody stand with me, would you please? This is the goodness of God. The goodness of God leads us to repentance. I've got one, if you could just stay with me for just 1 minute. The goodness of God leads us to repentance. God's not willing that any perish. Listen, he's not willing that any perish. Listen to me, because this is very important. I've said everything that I've said this morning to say this. Listen to me. God is long-suffering, not willing that any would perish, but that everyone would come to life. But you must understand that the wrath of God rests upon ISIS. The wrath of God rests upon the worst kind of people that you don't like. Your wrath may. And I'm sure in your justice system, your wrath is just. Your wrath abides upon those people who did such an evil thing to you and violated you and whatever. No. Understand this. The wrath of God abides upon all sin. Listen to me. There are many people who are ashamed of the reality that God is wrathful and full of vengeance against sin and iniquity. They're ashamed of it. But at the end of God's mercy and grace, when people rejected it, it's the day of vengeance. Right now he's saying to proclaim the acceptable day of the Lord. God declares his salvation in the context of his mercy. But if you reject that mercy, there's vengeance and wrath and a day of judgment and fiery indignation. This is reality. People want to have a great awakening without Jonathan Edwards, you know, revelation. Jonathan Edwards preached Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God based upon this one text that I'm getting ready to read you as you're standing here. And it changed a nation. It shook a nation, the United States of America. Today, it seems like many people want to erase this because they say it's a contradiction to John 3:16. It's no contradiction to John 3:16. John 3:36, it's not a contradiction to John 3:16. John 3:16 is God presenting his love and his grace to all mankind in the context of his mercy. John 3:36 is God's declaration and warning to all men who are going to who would refuse his love, who would refuse a way of escape, who says, no, I'm good. I like the way that I am living, and I don't want your stuff. God has a just and a holy and a righteous wrath upon murder and rape and hate and lie and abuse and strife and adultery. Adultery is another form of murder. Murders relationships and destroys every child in the family. spiritually. God comes and remedies that and work a miracle for them. I can go on and on. If we analyzed every act of sin, it would destroy you and everybody around you. It is a plague. It is a curse. Satan makes it to look good and desirable, but it is a plague of disease of the worst kind. Men are all excited because virologists are able to more proactively define various different viruses and strains of viruses to be able to shut down that viral contamination. Woo, everybody's all excited. Well, you should be, because that's good, because we're destroying something that will destroy mankind. Hello? But then we want to talk about the ultimate disease and act like God somehow is unrighteous because of his wrath against it. He's righteous to destroy hate. He's righteous to destroy murder so it will not exist anymore. He's righteous to destroy every evil thing. He's righteous to destroy death. He's righteous. He's righteous. I want to be with him. I want to be with him. Today is an opportunity for you to choose, who do you want to be with? Who do you want to be your leader? Because I'm telling you right now, if you think you're the leader, you are really living in a bubble. Every human being is led and fashioned and formed by things far more clever than they. Societies, cultures, governments, and a spiritual realm even bigger than that. Father's made a way. He's come in his mercy and his grace. A holy God has come in his mercy and his grace and given us the privilege and opportunity to make him our leader. And you can guarantee, you can be confident that his love will not change, his mercy will not change, his faithfulness will not change. That you put your trust in him, he has promised and he's vowed, he's sworn an oath to perfect everything that concerns you, to keep you unto that day, to be the author and finisher of your faith, the beginner and the completer of it. But you've got to trust him. Trust him means you walk with him. You obey him. You obey him. John chapter 6, verse 36 says, he that believes on the Son has everlasting life. It's God's life. And literally, this is in the context of obeying. And I'm going to show you more perfectly. Obeying what he said. To obey what God said. This is your Savior. Put your trust in him. And he says, and he that disobeys the Son. I know that many translations like the King James probably is one of the only translations that actually put this particular Greek word that does not mean believe not. It means to disobey. And there's many ways to say believe not. Many ways in the Greek language. And this is not one of them. Says, literally, those who disobey the Son. Why? Because not being willing to refuse him as Savior, Redeemer. To refuse the love of God truly is the most flagrant act of disobedience. He said, but those who disobey the Son, the wrath of God remains on them. Remains. People think that they can somehow believe that we're all children of God. We're not. The Bible doesn't teach that we're all children of God. Oh, we're all just children of God. No, we're not. Jesus said, even to the religious people in Judaism, your father is the devil. Jesus was the only one that could come along and pray this new prayer and teach his disciples to pray it, our Father. Because it's a whole new dimension, whole new dispensation, a transition from being lost, children of the devil, those that belong to a realm of darkness, and now being brought into the goodness and the mercy of God's life through the miracle of salvation, being made sons. Christ Jesus, as the only begotten Son, is the first definition of God being Father. Hello. He's the first definition of God being Father. You can't celebrate Father's Day if you don't have a son. Hello. The definition of being a father is to have a child, a son or a daughter. God's given us the opportunity to become sons and daughters. And now all you have to do is be willing to now do it His way. He wants you to be in church all the time. Why? So you can be taught. Say, so can I be taught at home? Sure, but not as well. Because the way God set it up is that you got to have, He's put apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to perfect you, to build you up, to do the work of the ministry, to do the work of the Holy Ghost. You won't be like the people you hang around. And the people that you like to hang around is the kind of people you are. Should I say that again?
Yes.
You're going to be like the people that you hang around. And the people that you like to hang around is the people you are. Father, we thank You that You invited us into Your family. And that You brought us here to this place by the miracle of the new birth. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Father, we pray that in this house here today, every single person who's called upon Your name will begin to live your life. That every person in this place will recognize that believing on You is obeying You, and the obedience to You is to recognize a change of life. That old things are passed away. Not that old things are passing away. Old things are gone.
Yes. Amen.
And we have zero tolerance for them to return.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know how many ways to say it. I don't know how loud to scream it, but God loves you. God, He loves you. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Listen to me. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. But that's not a relationship love. Understand me. That's God's love and is extended to mercy to all human beings. Everybody. He said, if you obey Me, Jesus said, if you obey Me, then My Father will love you. And you need to get that one too, because John 3:16, people have gotten that. But you need to get also John 14:21-24. He said, if you obey Me, if you'll obey Me. Jesus said, if you'll obey Me, then My Father will love you. And we will come and make our dwelling in your life. I have evidence and proof that Father dwells in me. That Christ Jesus dwells in me, that the Holy Ghost dwells in me, because I desire what He desires. And I can discover what He desires because He's given me a declaration of what it is He desires. It's called His Word. And I'm going to tell you today, if your life is not consecrated and committed to living what He says in His Word, your life is not right. You are wrong. You're on your way to an eternity without God because you've allowed deception through disobedience to take hold of your life. And I'm telling you, the more days you spend doing this, the stronger that lie takes hold of you and the less chance or probability that you'll ever break away. Somebody said, how about the thief on the cross? The thief on the cross never had a chance before. Besides that, you're not. And the backslider is in a place far worse than a thief on a cross because he was not a backslider. Listen to me. God loves you. He's calling you back. He gives you a lifetime to repent. No one can tell you how long that lifetime is. Hello, people, get right. This is too much. There's too much at stake for you to be prideful and arrogant about what you think. Because Father has brought it down to a leveling ground, and He says you have no right or excuse to believe or to think anything other than what I've told you. You forgive those who need to be forgiven. You loved everybody the way I love you. You show mercy. You lay down your life. He has totally erased any possibility of anyone having an excuse to be different than he is. All of this is a declaration that you came to a crossroad in your life and you decided to go with you. You decided to go with your feelings, your thoughts, your emotions, your intellect, your ideas, your perception. God's road is clear. And there are no excuses for not walking it. His love and His mercy is calling out to you, beckoning you to come. God beckons you to get right. He pleads with you to get right. He pleads with you. And in that plea, He's got a cry and a warning that is repeated over and over again, even in the New Testament. I posted it this morning on my Facebook. And that plea and that declaration is His judgment, His fiery indignation, and His wrath that is poured out upon all sin and iniquity. And people think that murder is worse than unforgiveness. It's not. People think that homosexuality is worse than rebellion against authority in your life. It's not. You're supposed to submit to authority. People say, well, I am submitted to authority. You know where you're going to find out whether you're submitted to authority? As soon as somebody tells you something that you disagree with. And let me qualify that. As soon as someone tells you what God has decided, what God declares, and you disagree with it, that is certain. Huh? So I pray today, whatever's going on in your life, whatever's happening in your life, you let those things, the issues, the problems, be cured. Be cured now. Be cured now. Because for you to say no to God today makes it more certain that you will say no to Him tomorrow, and next year will be even worse. And 10 years from now, you better humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Do it today. Do it today. God presents His salvation in the context of His mercy. But to reject His mercy, to reject His love, brings a fiery indignation and a certainty of judgment. And he says to those cities, listen to me, He says to those cities in which He went with His mercy, and He didn't say anything other than mercy, come and live. In Matthew chapter 11, when he went into Bethsaida, when He went into Chorazin, when He went into Capernaum, He was just there loving and showing the mercy of God and healing and delivering and saying, turn to God. The kingdom of God is at hand. Turn to God. Turn to God. And all these miracles and signs and wonders about turn to God, turn to God. And they wouldn't. And they refused His love. They would not turn. They wanted to go on in the religious ideology. He said, it would be more tolerable for you in the day of judgment. It would be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than it will be for you. And He went through the list. When you think about more tolerable, wow. Wow. People who have stood in the presence of the living God and have refused the love and the mercy of Jesus Christ and refused the instruction and the guidance of the Holy Ghost, hell is far worse for them than the lake of fire described for the lost. And you better listen to me. You better listen to me. Because it's not a touchy-feely subjective thing. God's word is certain. It's forever settled in heaven. You'll find out that every day your heart won't become more tender and sensitive. It'll become more hardened and defiant. You won't become more malleable and broken. You'll become more self-confident and self-reliant. Don't tarry. Don't wait. God gives you a lifetime to repent, but your lifetime may be over by this afternoon. It's said, well, I just went to the doctor. I've got a good health checkup. I know people that have gone to the doctor, had a great health checkup, and by the afternoon they died. And about your doctor telling you how long you're going to live. It is appointed unto men once to die, and after that, it's judgment. Don't be deceived. God will not be mocked. God will not be mocked. God will not be mocked. He searches the hearts of every man. He tries the hearts of every man. People say to me, yeah, well, this is why we don't come to church there. Because you always bring in this to this place of intense decision. You make it so intense. It is intense. Your eternity is intense. God's begging us. He's begging us to live. He's begging us to choose life and live. He pleads with us to show us that our own way is just destruction. It's self-destruction. Your attitudes will be reproduced in your children tenfold, and it will come back in an attitude that they have against you. I've watched it. I've watched parents live in offense against ministry, and their children, I watched their children grow, and their children hate their parents because the offense that they had against God was tenfold in their life against their parents. It's a spiritual law. God will not be mocked. What you sow, you will reap. You want to have days of heaven upon earth, then you have to obey God. God said, simply obey me and you'll have days of heaven upon earth. I'm telling you what you've got to do. In other words, God is saying, I'm telling you what you've got to do in order for it to work out good. And if you don't do it, it's a spiritual violation that is going to come back on you. And it's you, and it's not me that did it. It's you. You are unwilling to hear, to walk in the way of life and live. I can go back in my mind 34 years ago. And I can see people. Some of them are dead now. Some of them have violent situations in their life now. Some of them have grandchildren and their children hate them. So how much worse is it for the grandchildren? I don't remember God pleading with them, begging them to change their attitude, to change their mind and have His attitude and have His mind. Begging them to forgive, begging them to renounce the offense, begging them to turn from their sin, begging them. They're very confident in their choices, what they believed in their opinion. They're not anymore. They're not anymore. They're just hurt. If you disobey God, you'll be blessed. If you just put the kingdom first, you'll be blessed. If you just walk with the Holy Spirit, you'll be blessed. For the righteous will flourish like the palm tree. God will take your seed and He'll make your seed mighty in the earth. And your children and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. And if God should have mercy, your great-great-grandchildren will rise up and love you and kiss you and bless you. And they, their children, and their grandchildren, on in subsequent generations. So long as they led in the ways of life. In closing, I think there's nothing more wonderful than coming to the knowledge of how deeply He loves us. You know, as I was holding little Ezekiel, and how passionately I love him. To be so blessed to have the revelation that Father loves me that much more. That's why I do the things I do. I don't do them out of obligation. That's why I serve Him, because I've discovered how much He loves me, and in that I love Him. There's nothing I won't do. And His grace supplies it. And I pray that that's the life that you'll choose. Let God bless you. Let God bless you. Let God bless you. Somebody said, well, I tried the Lord and it didn't work out for me. It didn't work out for you because you never obeyed Him. You want the blessings and the fruits of obedience. But you're unwilling to obey. It doesn't work that way. Not in any context of life. Come on now. Here it is. Step-by-step instructions. Here it is. Literally an answer for every situation. My wife and I, we just moved. God moved us. He moved us. And He gave us this amazing place. And I said to my wife, I said, what does that Indian word mean, the street that we live on? And what it means is, you're richly blessed. And I said to her, I said, well, I didn't need the name of the street that we moved to convince me. That's step-by-step instructions. Step-by-step instructions. The righteous flourish like a palm tree. Everything they do is blessed. Their children are mighty in the earth. All I got to do is serve God, and my children will serve Him with greater intensity. All I got to do is follow God and believe all of the signs and wonders and miracles, and my children will step into even a greater display of signs and wonders and miracles. And they, their children, and their children. Because that's the way the Lord does it. He develops it in families. It's the way He does it. He gives it to us all individually, personally, but it's like He amplifies it from generation to generation to generation to generation. We are the people of God, and He is our Lord. We are the people of the Lord, and He is our God. My goodness. Don't turn away from this. Don't turn away from this. If you'll just receive His love, you'll wake up every morning super happy. You'll hate sin and communion with it. You'll feel just terrible if you got any kind of problems going on in relationships. Because God's Holy Ghost conviction will be there correcting you, leading you, guiding you. Every day you make your heart that much more sensitive. Hallelujah. You stay in communion. Let me just say this. You stay in communion with the Holy Ghost, and you don't have to do what you do out of legalism. You stay in communion with the Holy Ghost, and if you're watching the wrong thing on television, you'll feel like somebody stabbed you with a hot knife in your heart. You'll lose joy, you'll lose your peace. Praise God, you can get it back real quick. As soon as you turn that thing off, boom. It's just how he guides us with things that are far more accurate than what you would be able to see with your eyes. It's true. Well, amen. If you're watching me by web right now or by YouTube, Jesus is calling you. He loves you. He's begging you to come. He's begging you to leave the life that you've been living and come into His life that He showed us. One last time here this morning, people. If you've never received the gift of God, the miracle of salvation, Father wants you to have it now. He's begging you. Father is literally leading you to Jesus. Here's how the mercy works. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. I know what He's doing. He's drawing all men to Him. His love, His mercy, His grace. If we reject such love and grace, I promise you the end, the consequence you do not want to have in your life. Because there's no other way. There's no other way of escape. God's pleading with you. He's begging you. Maybe some of you walk with the Lord and you gave yourself over to the Lord, but you've not been living for Him. You're not obeying Him. The evidence of your life is that you're not obeying Him, and you know that, and I don't need to be convincing anybody. You know. You need to get that right. You need to get right today. Don't wait till tomorrow. Get right today. Don't leave this place not being right. It's so simple. All you do is you return to God. And Father has granted us the privilege and the power to return to God by saying, Lord Jesus, wash me. Cleanse me. Take your blood and apply it to my life. Holy Spirit, strengthen me. Renew the joy of salvation in me. I'm going to follow you. Forgive me for my wrong. Forgive me for disobeying. Forgive me for turning away. I'm going to follow you. Take hold of me now. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to give myself to you, oh God, to do it your way, not to do it my way. It's just that simple. What could be easier? From the heart, because God, the Father knows whether you're lying to him or not. And when you mean it, it's not a lie. When you mean it, when it's in your heart, you mean it. It's not a lie. Instantaneously, Father removes all the offense away, destroys it. Hallelujah. He's so good. I love his presence so much. You know, you can call upon the Lord when he's near. He's near right now. I had a preacher say, listen, I had a preacher face message me this morning. He said, you know, I watch your services all the time. He said, I'm getting ready to go in to preach. And he said, I got back pain, pain in my lumbar region and my neck and my shoulders. He said, I'm just in such pain. He said, and I don't know who the guy is. I've never met him. I'm sure he's a wonderful man of God. He said, and I just felt I got to call you. I've got to face message you right now for you to pray for me. And as soon as I read that, I felt the anointing. I felt the presence of the Lord. So I said, you be healed right now in the name of Jesus. Because when he's near, come on. This is, people got to learn how to have a relationship because they calling on the Lord and he's nowhere to be felt. But oh, when he's near, you call upon him while he's near, watch out. And I said, in the name of Jesus, be healed right now. And he had already sent something else to me before he said that. He said, agree with me right now. And so I had already told him, it's done. And so then I just emailed back. I said, start moving your neck around, start moving your arms around, start worshiping God. It's finished. Hallelujah. Come on, people. It's just that simple with Father. It's just that simple. Come on. He loves you so much. Come on. Thank you, Lord Jesus. To some of you, it's just simply forgive. You know what forgive is? It's giving before you're even asked. That's forgive. You can give, that's immediate. Forgive is done before you ever even, it was already done deal before you needed to give. Are you with me? That's forgive. It's like foreknowledge. Are you with me? Come on, people. Come on, we're here to break you out of your prison. We're here to break you out. And I know you look around. We have people all over the world watching us right now. We have people all over the world. The amount of people in most states of the United States of America is wonderful. The audience is pretty big here, actually. And there are a lot of needs. And sometimes people are looking around going, my, who is he laboring so intently with by the Spirit of the Lord? There's a lot of people being represented by that camera. Praise God for it. That we are able to reach into the nations of the earth. And we just pray in Jesus' name that you standing here especially, you receive the full benefit. The full benefit. Hallelujah. The Lord says, I write these things to you that your joy may be full. Because if you'll obey him, you'll get so happy that nothing can make you happier. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, I want to say this. Thank you so much for everybody who generously have been given to the church plant and to building the church in Oregon. If you didn't get to see the door, and some of you gave very generously for the door, and thank you so much. I promise you, every penny that went for the door went to the door. And it's an amazing door. We posted it on Facebook. I just figured, you know, we're building this church, and I'm looking at doors, and I'm saying, Lord, you know, it's not that it's essential, but it's like, Lord, you're the door. And I want something that looks good. It's really representative of you being the door. And so, you know, miraculously, I found this $14,000 door for $6,000, you know, just amazing door. It's like 10 foot tall and just amazing stuff. Amazing woodwork. When you see it, you recognize why it's $14,000. And we got it for $6,000, and it's paid for, and it's ours, and we have it, and we just got to put it in. And thank you for participating with that and partnering with us in that, because we see what God is doing among another unreached people group right here in the United States of America, a bunch of ranchers who haven't had a church to go to and wanting something that's real and genuine. There's so many people just like, come on, give me something that's real. I don't want no more religion. I want people to really love each other. And it's not love today and hate me tomorrow. It's not we're here today and we like you today and never going to leave, and tomorrow we're off doing our own thing. It's about time God's people start living like God's people. Amen. So also, listen, once again, every act of obedience results in great miracles. Understand this. You obey God, and you're going to be blessed. It just opens yourself up. It's like obedience gives God's permission to bless you. And that's why we allow you to participate with God and with us in giving. Because the Lord told us, if you honor Him with your substance, with your tithes and your offerings, He's promised over and again, and this is New Testament doctrine as well, to take that, whatever little you give, or whatever you give, whatever much you give, and multiply it. But it's got to be done in the realms of faith. It can't be done begrudgingly, that you have to. It's some kind of legalistic thing, because then it ain't going to work. That's what Paul is saying to the church of Corinth. It's not going to work that way. It's because you're involved in worship, and you're involved in obeying God, and there's a miracle in it, because you know what He wants to do. You know how He wants to increase blessings in your life and provision in your life. And so we allow you to participate with us in this, because it's as much a part of the gospel as anything else. When a woman gave, she gave a year's worth, what was equivalent to a year's worth of wage in worshiping the Lord Jesus and pouring it out on the Lord Jesus. And he said, this is a memorial that will be spoken of as long as the gospel is preached. Jesus was impacted by people's giving. That's why he stood over by the offering basket. I mean, today, what if I come in and I took up the offering kind of like this? Okay, everybody, you need to come and give. And I watched and evaluated everything that you put in there. You'd say, you know what, that could be manipulative. Yeah, you're right. That's why I'm not going to do it. But Jesus kind of did it. And he's like looking at everything that everybody put in. And he noticed, you got to be looking close to watch a widow put in two mites. Boom, boom. You got to be watching close to recognize that it wasn't, you know, come on. It could have been two of any, you know, coinage of the day, right? He knew exactly how much it was. He was watching. Because he's telling us something. Hello. There's nothing there that's just redundant or just, hey, let's just, we look, I can't think of what to say, so let's just throw that in there too. I remember this one thing, so let's throw that in. No, his Father telling us, here's what's going on. I'm going to do what I do today. I'm going to do what I do today because Father's looking at me. I'm in a relationship with Him. I've set Him before me in my right hand that I should not be moved. It ain't going to be about man. It ain't going to be about appearances. Do this. I promise you, you'll step into the multiplication that God has promised. You'll step into the supernatural provision that He fully is dedicated to giving us. So you just worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offerings. Find everybody around you. Hug them. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. If there's anybody in the place you want me to pray with you and for you, I promise you God will touch you. I promise you He will heal you. And the monte estila monte erosia, He has strengthened you. Borishimande lebokorosana. He'll open up your eyes and give you an understanding. Hallelujah. Haromonde kaya basitaya. To lay hold on the inheritance. Nombrosili di kana moshi kadera. Linem and eshi protusatikast. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Father, I thank you that you take a hold of your servant. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, I break off any stronghold, anything that would try to lay sway to the opinion and to the emotion, to the appetite. Satan, I break off your strongholds right now, your lies, and every claim that you have to the property of God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You be not be held back by something of the past. You not be entangled by a wrong choice. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, just receive right now into your inner being. Receive right now to your spirit. Strength, wisdom, hallelujah. Wisdom that will catapult you out of being 16 years old. Hallelujah. Wisdom that will take you beyond being 16, hallelujah. Borazazito Romande Adusteke Runom Jingling Namburastaya Malataradea Mombrandaya Manashek Talamo Shambrai Haleopona And. Thank you, Jesus. Now, in Jesus' name. Now, speak into your spirit right now. Now, in Jesus' name. The ability to stand against every stronghold, every lie of the enemy. Every afflicting, tormenting thing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Mambrasa da da da. The ability to be mighty. Moraza de in. Berishambrostai in Barates Loco. Mighty, Morise. Mighty in battle. Mighty in Dorosoya in Amasta in the commitments. Strong in self control. Strong in self-control. Baby, come here. How are you doing, darling? Are you doing good? How are you doing?
My name's Timmy.
Pardon?
My name's Timmy.
Pleasure to meet you, dear. Bless you. So, you need anything? At where you've been going to church? There's a good starting spot right there.
Good.
That's right. There's where you. That's Step number two. Step number one, of course, is surrendering your life over to Him, letting Him work the miracle of salvation in your life. Step number two is obeying Him and getting in the community where He can teach you, grow you, strengthen you. So in the name of Jesus, you make that decision and don't back down from it. Make the right decisions and do what's right. Yeah? Because everything that you have good going on in your life is because at some point in time you made a correct decision and you stuck with it no matter what. And it worked out, a blessing. And that is on a much smaller scale than what Father has for you as to what He wants you to do. So in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to be blessed, strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord in your inner being, so that you'll do what's right, you'll make the right decisions, you'll obey God, you'll walk with Him, you'll let God come and fill you up with every good thing, train you up in His Word and by His Spirit. Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Susan, it is me. No, I see it. I see that. I see that. We're gonna get them more blessed. Hallelujah. Put your arms around Papa, give him a hug so I can pray for you. Put your arms around Papa, give him a hug.
Big hug.
Jesus Christ, I break the power of every fear, every torment. I break the power of it now in the name of Jesus. No oppressing, fearful thing. The Abraham dominance over my baby in Jesus. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Healed.
Yes.
Strengthened.
Yes.
Touched right now. Father, I thank You that Your divine order is in this house, in this home. Oh God, that the glory of Your love is manifested in this relationship in every way. Oh God, that the beauty and the splendor of that which You purchased for us at Calvary is fully realized by Your servants. In every dimension of their family, oh God, Your goodness and Your blessings are revealed. Yes. Hallelujah. That everything that You purchased and paid for us to have will be realized by Your servants and by their children. Hallelujah. That they have days of heaven upon earth. That every dimension of their marriage be as a marriage made in heaven. Hallelujah. That every step, oh God, is ordered by You. That they walk in all Your direction, Holy Spirit. baptized in your glory, baptized in your fire and your power. Hallelujah. Walking in divine provision and divine health and divine strength and divine blessings. Living out a divine life. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for baby. She's so pretty. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for baby. Thank you, Lord.
Bless you.